that, those meetings will be forthcoming, and we'll see where it goes. But that's just kind of a brief update where we're at. Bottom line is that our police department's gonna be short of this amount of money this year. And it's also important to note that even though that 4% has not technically been triggered for almost a decade or more, the actual billing that we get from the county is actually more than what really the 35% is. So the chief and Bill get the bill that's much higher. In fact, I think, what, last year, chief, it was about 16% higher?
16 more than they would, that they billed us last year.
Right.
That should bill us.
So, you know, you can kind of look at this and kind of get the gist of where I'm going, but it almost seems as if their overall operations budget over there is not increasing as it probably should either. So that's why it's triggering some of this down to us. Bill, do you have any more to add?
I think the last point you just made, I think that's something John is looking into in his budget, and we'll look and see if there's anything significant of what you're saying, we'll bring that back to you. But at this point, just to be clear, we're in the just asking questions stage.
And, you know, just like I told everybody the other night, even with a member of the Board of Supervisors there, I don't regret the decision we made 14 some years ago to take the communications center out of the police department. It makes sense for everything to come into one communications center, especially in a county our size. But, and we don't mind paying for that. We'll pay for that, our responsibility for the city. But we want to just make sure that it's fair for everybody throughout the county and it's done in the proper way. So,
I have a question. Who has the authority to institute that levy? Is it the Board of Supervisors or does it go to a public vote?
Well, that's a good question.
Yeah.
We have had at least 12 years of discussing this, and we have about 6 different opinions from the Attorney General's office that says that the Emergency Management Commission has the right to, by code, to create this levy. All right, their commission does. It's made up of elected officials. They have the right to do it. The Board of Supervisors does not feel that that's correct. I think even if we took a vote tomorrow and it went to them, they would say they're not gonna institute it. And it may get to a point where some of this may have to be legally challenged down the road. I have no idea where it will go. But if you read the code, I agree with the Attorney General's opinion. They have 6 of them over about 12 years that says that they have the right to do it. And if we have a budget that we present that says that that should be fulfilled, the board has an obligation to fulfill it. They have a different opinion of that.
Sure.
So,
and then that the commission would set the levy.
They would set the levy, and I think part of the reason the board has such an issue with it is because they feel that as the elected board members for the county, that if you have an issue with taxes, they're going to be coming to them.
Sure.
And we maintain as a commission, just simply tell them to come to the commission.
Mm-hmm.
We're all elected officials on there. We'll explain to them why we've imposed this.
Okay. So,
thanks.
Thanks.
Even with the highest levy, what would that translate to?
You know, I've seen some numbers in the past. I think I don't think it would be, if I can remember right, it's no more than maybe like $30 a year on an average home, you know. But as I tell people, you know, I know that they're concerned about rural valuation and how that can impact how much people have to pay out in rural, but the fact of the matter is, all that land that they have is still covered under public safety, so if something's happening out there, they want a response just like anyone that lives in town. So, it's just a fair way to handle it.
Stephen, the fire that was up on Nature Road, perfect example.
Right.
Outside city limits. Yep, and it was communication and personnel across the county that answered.
Right. Absolutely. More to come.
Thanks for looking at that.
Okay, utility committee. Stephen.
No report. I think we have a meeting next week.
Yes.
Tuesday, probably 4, so I'll be
there.
Catch a bus and join us.
Economic development, great.
No report.
Okay. Number 5. five department reports, building official Ed?
No report.
Finance officer Andrea?
We just completed the shoving down in our archive room, it looks really great, if you guys wanna take a walk down there, for the meeting, or sometime, just stop in. We don't have the, we just moved some boxes in, it's not organized yet, it just got completed, but it looks really, really nice, so thank you.
City attorney Jim?
No report.
Director of Public Works, John Rouse is not with us this evening, but I bet Wayne will handle this report.
Thank you, Your Honor. First item would be the certificate of substantial completion with the Public Works building remodel. All work has been completed, we are still working through a few of the final issues with moisture concern on the east end where our trucks are coming in very wet and covered in ice and the evaporation process. So we're still looking a little bit there, and then a few repairs need to be made to the roof yet. Those are all warranty items, so I guess we put on here for the retainer to be released, is that the final retainer to the general contractor to be released. The rest of the things are all valued under warranty.
We'll need a motion on that.
What's the retainer? How much was the retainer, you know, then?
It's $28,000.
Okay, then we're gonna release that.
And that actually won't be released for 30 days.
Right.
We have some gas and water now, so we hold off 30 days, and nothing will be released until it's to our satisfaction.
That's good, because,
yeah.
Never mind.
Okay, is there a motion?
Motion.
Second. Call the roll.
Kip?
Yes.
Kirkland?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Gray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Second item there, that also needs motion and vote.
Mm-hmm.
Change order for number three on Public Works building, I believe that is just a simple communication cap tie line and RCA cable to a TV outlet on our break room that the engineers had in there, and we didn't feel it was necessary, we omitted it, and we made sure that we were credited $250 back in that project.
Okay, very good.
So moved.
Second. Call the roll.
Kirkland?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Gray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Kip?
Yes.
And number three, kind of the number one, the final completion of the building. Like I said, everything left on the project is considered being warranty work, so.
Okay. We don't need to. Thank you.
Thank you.
City engineer Dan?
No report, Your Honor.
Public safety chief Adams, not on vacation, Chief Weevil?
Yes, just real briefly, we have just a few more days left to take applications for the Citizens Police Academy. We have a few spots left, so if you wanna join us for that, or know anybody that wants to, please have them get their applications in by Friday. That's it, thank you.
Thanks. City engineer, Bill?
Thank you, sir. My first item is, we have some underground storage tanks that surround basically City Hall, there's 13 of them. We've been working at getting those capped, and there is an underground storage tank fund that will help you pay for this. The bill from Senate company that will do it is just about $2,300. We have obtained that funding from the underground storage tank fund. We see the letter, which is on the screen there, telling us that they will pay that amount. So in the packet where we sent you is the agreement with Seneca. Here it shows what work they're gonna do or what they're billing for the almost $2,300. And then there's an agreement here that John Rouse signed. And it also has the agreement. You'll notice on number nine, that was redacted. That was something that we were uncomfortable with signing, as far as if they found something, what costs and everything like that. Company said it rarely happens, redacted. If you want, we took the opportunity to redact it, and that's why that's redacted. And here is a map. of where they are. They're in yellow, which they'll be filling. Waylon, you have anything to add that I haven't stated on this that they should know?
Great deal to take care of them. I put the lids on. I'm sure you've seen them. They're nuisance in the back. There's, I don't feel any reason to have them here.
What are they?
They're monitoring test wells that they use to sample the water and stuff for petroleum and filtration back in the days, and they just happen to be on our property because of the surrounding areas. I don't know if it has to do with possibly an oil fire generator from this building back in the day. They're all over in the parking lots in the back. Metal covers pop up in the alley. Pieces of plastic pipe stick out.
So, if I can get a motion to approve this work.
I'm moving.
I'm sorry. Oh, it is a consent? I'm sorry. My fault. That's all I'm saying.
How old are these things?
Been here since 2000.
Been there a long time.
Okay.
They didn't say like FDR was here.
No, no. Their plates have been driven over so much, they're smooth on the top. They've been there a long time.
They just,
we had a bunch.
They just provide us a report. Is that what they do, basically?
They take it?
Yes.
But they've been.
Okay, my second item for council and mayor is the GBL contract. It's in front of you. I put one on your desk. It'll give you a chance to look at it. So this is a contract for the last 3 years. This, so you know, this expires on March 1st, 2019. You'll see that the amount of this contract is $48,248.64 per year. So it ends May 1st. This is a contract with them where city employees can go to them if they have problems with health insurance. And then they take the issue with the employee. And Andrea works with me more than, works on this one than I do, so step in if I'm misstating this. And then that goes on to another company where they check it out, comes back, I think, to GBL, and then it's solved through. They get back with the employee. If you remember in September, when I asked permission that we made some changes in the front office, and just before that time, we were going to be working with the county to maybe share a human resource position with them, if you remember back then, and then they chose not to do that with us. So as we move forward and moved an employee into the payroll specialist position, that was also our plan, was to look at human resources then for our city to work on those types of job tasks. So we have a person in that position right now that certainly could do the task that GBL has been doing. I look tonight as three options, and you can certainly change them if you wish, is to look at extending this contract with GBL that would expire on May 1st, 2019, bid this service out and get quotes for another company, or the third option could be is for your staff to take these tasks on, at least for here for a year, and to perform those and work with the employees to answer their health insurance questions or any other insurance questions they have. Andre each year signs a form that has to do with HIPAA. That part is certainly covered with the city, with city employees doing that. Instead of staff, I'll say me. I think that this is something that staff can do and handle those complaints. The numbers I've got, Danette from GBL is back there. She may speak, or you work with Gabe. Okay, Gabe Bowers. And she may have something to say. And the numbers I got was around four times a week is the contact with employees from Bowers. So you're looking at, you know, a couple hundred times a year, four times a week. I certainly think that if council chose to save this money and have staff do it, that's certainly an option for you. And I'll take, and go ahead, Danette, if you'd like to say something, please do.
I'm Danette Lind. I'm with Bowers Insurance Group. Prior to Bowers Insurance Group, I actually was with GBL, which was the general agency that Gabe Bowers partnered with. There's two Works, and I'm sure Greg could probably help with that a little bit. But Dave Bowers is your local presence. So Bowers Insurance Group is your local presence here in the city of Boone. We service the city of Boone employees. And in partnership with GBL, GBL is a general agency. A general agency is what agents like ourselves do to use as leverage. So with a general agency, they're the largest general agency in the state of Iowa. And so they are able to use their clout, for a better use of other words, but to use their leverage to partner with carriers. So your carriers, what we're asking for here is your the contract with GBL for the United Healthcare or the ITAP group. And then in addition to that, we also have all of your ancillary products. That would be your dental, vision, and the like. And so with GBL, what we do when we go and market your group, right now you haven't had to market for a while, but if we had to market your group, we can use GBL's leverage with the in their partnership with the carriers that they have to help negotiate. Otherwise, I'm not sure how you would go out and market if you ever needed to look for other coverage. I would like to, welcome you to ask questions. It might be easier just to have an open discussion and go that way. But I wanted to kind of explain the tier and how GBL is involved. A little bit of history. I previously worked with GBL for almost 5 years. And so I'm very familiar with the city of Boone employees. I have been the backside or the back office for Bowers Insurance Group for almost 5 years. May of last year, Gabe and I talked and we thought it would be a good idea to come in local. And so now I am an employee of his. I handle 100% of the city of Boone membership, enrollment, and then also any claims or service issues. We have approximately 3 to 5 employees come in per week with claims and service issues or just general questions about their benefits. They could be walking in with a shoebox full of EOBs that they want to help sort through. So we feel that this level of service that we provide the city of Boone employees is definitely there. I just wanted to provide a little bit of history of why that GBL is involved there and why they're what the contract is.
How many city employees on average come in, ask a question, but then may be referred to IPAP directly?
No city of Boone employees would go directly to IPAP. They don't have that access.
Okay. Because the only concern that I'm having is that I don't want to be, we have to watch every penny that we're spending. Okay. And that's kind of where we're at. And I just have concerns that, I want to make sure that our employees are getting the right attention when they come and they're not being pushed off to anybody else. Because if that is the case, then there wouldn't be any reason for us to not have someone at the city level, just be the intermediary and save that $150,000 over 3 years, basically.
That was my partnership with Dave Bowers had nothing to do with the city of Boone. It was part of it, but by bringing me in house, it gave the city of Boone employees 100% access to just come in and ask questions and be that resource for them. Because of my background, I'm able to partner directly with the carriers. And able to resolve issues that they have. Because of HIPAA, I can't really tell you the types of things that people are coming in for, but it's claims. It's they don't understand how everything works. They may have a provider issue, an out-of-network type thing. And just with my experience, I'm able to assist them directly. They can sit right across my desk and we can resolve things immediately. In the past, it wasn't always that case. So in the past, it would go to GBL
it's a city employee and they work with Andrea, they see you all the time, how could they come to you with a health issue and keep that discreet?
Prior to, so we had Judy Allen and we also had Mike Young, and even with Mike Young, and so before Mike Young, we were self-insured and I handled all the claims. Actually, I got a bill every week with details of what everybody did. It's just part of my job for confidentiality. And I've spoken to retirees that have actually said, I really trust you and I really respect the fact that, you know, I can come to you and know that those things aren't going to go anywhere else because they've had years of experience with me on those things.
Sure.
And truly, I have so many things going on and coming into my office, I wouldn't remember anyway. At least not the details.
One of the things, to answer your question, Holly, is that as far as government goes, government agencies go, that's not uncommon, especially in state government that I'm familiar with. Your human resource people deal with that stuff all the time, and that's part of the reason why their doors are locked more than anybody else's, because there's records in there. It's just kind of a sacred thing, so yeah, it's not uncommon.
And I do still do the retirees. All the retirees that still comes to me.
Greg, what's your opinion? You're more knowledgeable on insurance and the death than I am, but most of us, I would say.
HIPAA is not an issue for me. There's training, there's the waivers that you sign as well. I've got experience with HR personnel from government to private. And just to be sure I was on the safe side as well, I made sure to make contact with Lisa down at the Iowa League of Cities, the human resource specialist, and she's actually one of the point people working with the county and the board of supervisors on their HR position. Lisa had no issues as well, and she says it's employee driven. So if the employee comes in, as long as the training is there, the personnel is there, you do your best for quality control in the hiring process, make sure your staff is up, it's no different. There's no additional liability than going through a private carrier like myself. So personally, that's not an issue for me.
I mean, overall, do you think this is a good idea?
Overall? Some backstory on this for some of the new council members. The whole reason we did this, when we looked through this, when GPO was on the table, was because Walmart was giving us annual increases of double digits. We did this, and we ended up saving almost $250,000 the first year in savings. That went to our budget. Now, that was at the time when we didn't have the staff to do that in-house. Now we have the ability to do that in-house, and we have the potential to save another $48,000 that might happen. And, you know, for a one-year trial run, we can save $48,000 and come back in a year, and then we can go out for an RFP and put it out for bid. And then the agent and carriers will come to us and bid their process as well. So I don't know exactly what the downside is personally.
So IPAP is who we're with. It's the Iowa Public Employers Pool. We partner with other cities, county schools that work with Steve Crater, which is the agent that manages the group. And he has the authority or ability to go out and bid every year. He goes out and does, and Vice will be meeting with him, I think, next month or at the end of this month. And he will go to UHC, which is our unit of healthcare, who is our provider now, try and get the rate. If those rates don't come in to a single digit or into a digit that we're all happy with, he will then go out to Blue Cross Blue Shield, because he has that ability to still go out and do those things. If forever there's an instance that we're not happy with IPAP or Steve Crater, what we did in the past is you don't go out and bid for Blue Cross of Blue Shield or Blue Cross Blue Shield or United Healthcare. What we do is we go out and bid for a new agent, and then they come in with their plan, and that's kind of how we go with whichever agent and whichever group we want to go with. So there is still the ability to do those things without the agreement with GBL Gate Bowers. I'm not sure how you want to classify that anymore, but we still have all the abilities that we have had in the past. We still have UHC and IPAP. We actually have the benefit of having multiple groups in this, because like the schools have more stricter than the city, and they push usually for a renewal or a bid, right, a bid every year, to make sure that we're getting the best rates possible.
And isn't that the process we used when we found the ABG deal to begin with?
Yes, it is, yes. Most definitely. So it's not that we typically go out and say, hey, we wanna get new, yeah, but if we're not happy with the group that we're with, it's not that we usually go out and just get bids for different providers. It's usually a bid for our agent slash broker, not our provider, and that's how we get our provider.
Exact same process that we followed with Hans in our current agent record. When we did our liability coverage, she came back and came back with $30,000 in savings, was at El City 1 year. Because we went to him and asked us, we asked for options, and he came back with those.
And I wanna make sure that I point out to council, Mayor, that when I started looking at this contract, it has nothing to do with the performance of GBL. I didn't even look at that. That's not the reason I would do that. I'm looking at this for pure of, is there cost savings to the city that council wants to consider? So this has, so I make it clear, it has nothing to do with the performance of GBL or Bowers Insurance Agency. This is purely efficiency and economics from my standpoint.
What I seem to be hearing here is that, and my understanding, because we use Give Bowers with our Stecker Concrete insurance, health insurance that we offer to our employees. So GBL, so there's GBL, then there's Gabe Bowers, happens to be the same initials, but it's Gabe Bowers Insurance underneath of that, and then that's IPEP.
There's layers.
Yeah. So do they all, are they all paid? Is this all going to Gabe?
No, so that's split between GBL and Gabe. But then there's, so those are the agents and brokers.
Do you want me to explain how?
The 48,000.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
So from that fee was set 9 years ago when the contract was written. At that time, agents, and we're going to talk about old pool insurance back at that time, agents usually took 5 to 7% of the premium as their commission. And so at the time, the agent that was of record for GBL, Gabe Bowers, had 5%, and GBL, Gabe Bowers, negotiated to 4%. That 4% is that dollar amount. That dollar amount has never changed for 9 years. So we've never taken an increase or decrease. And we could entertain that. We definitely could.
So just for clarification, the amount of the contract, that amount goes, that stays with Bowers Agency, or some of that goes to GBL?
So that goes, that flows to GBL.
I think that's the question.
Yep, it flows to GBL. GBL takes a percentage. As the general agency, they take a percentage. From that amount, then that is split. It used to be split 50-50. 50% went to an agent named Renee Johannemeyer. She is your agent of record currently. The other percent, the other 50% went to Gabe Bowers. And so we were your local presence. If anybody came in with a price issues, memberships, that type of thing, it would then be processed to GBL. GBL would do everything for them, and then it would come back. So that amount, back in June when I came to work directly with Gabe, and I think we're confusing it because I used to work with GBL, but when I came to work for Gabe, we changed our contract with Renee Johannemeyer. And so GBL still gets what they normally got. That is a general agency fee. That is for
industry
their,
standard.
Yeah, it's standard. That's just how it is. And it's how you are able to, as an agent, a small agent like ourselves, we are able to use a large general agency for the leverage to go out and market. Use with carriers if carriers have any carrier issues. So we renegotiated, and so now Renee Johannemeyer gets 25% and Gabe Bowers gets 75% of that.
48,000.
Yes.
Okay.
Minus the 20%. That's what it was.
Okay.
And to explain where IPEP fits in is, so they're our agents. So if we wanted to move from IPEP, they would go out and they would bid that for us. IPEP is our agent also. also slash broker in the fact that they go out and actually do part of their job for them, and the fact that they're doing the bidding and the quoting.
Because they also have to communicate with the other parties.
Exactly.
IPEP is an association, and so the association goes out to bid.
Sure.
Steve Prater is actually has his own brokerage.
Mm-hmm.
So he's an agent on his own too, but he manages the IPEP association.
But you have to be the agent of record for the association and manage the association.
Correct. So there's a small area there. IPEP does not, they're not a commission, so.
Based on what Bill said earlier, I don't have anything against dealing with GBL or Dean Bowers. I think that's all been good. But in light of the way that our budgets are every year and get tighter, it just seems to me that if we can have a savings where you can have someone in house being an intermediary with IPAP, it just seems to me to make some financial sense. But in a way to go that route, I guess at the end of the day, you kind of have to trust your staff. And if we have the staff member that's been identified that could do this, I don't see a reason why we couldn't at least try it a year and see if it works. If it does, fine. If it doesn't, we can go back and put it out for bidding, and even go back to where we were doing. But it's, you know, that's a good chunk of change to save. So I guess in light of that, I would support at least trying to do it in-house, because it just seems like any type of savings we can look at is worth it to the taxpayers. So.
Okay. Can I say one thing?
Yeah.
And we wonder why our insurance system is broken. 50 million people got to go through something. It's ridiculous. And I must see that. Let's do it in-house.
Well, I will make a motion that we go ahead and...
Can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
The thing that I don't want to see is to get in a position where, say, we moved away from IPAP for some reason, it wasn't... Then we would have to go find a new broker. Is that correct? The correct terminology? And they would have to put it out for bid.
What would happen is we'd be covered under our coverage for the grace period for the contract.
Okay.
So if we ever decided IPAP came back with a rate increase we could not stomach, we would just go out and ask for bids from local agencies like GBL and Gage.
Okay.
And then they would come in and give us options to choose from.
Okay.
Whether it's Walmart, United,
sure,
any one of the providers that are very reliable.
Okay. So I don't want to put our employees in a position where
they're
knocked over the head with, you know.
Yeah, that wouldn't be my understanding that we would have that issue.
I just have to say that I feel like I've gone through this, I've been down this road, and it just doesn't feel like one place is safe to save money and put on your, just one more thing on your plate. I just am having a hard time. I think we send it out for bid, certainly, and see what's still out there, but just putting this all on your plate.
Okay, to be clear, if I could just check, Andrea will supervise the person that's doing it, but there's a staff that we've identified that will be doing the task.
Specifically?
Yes.
As part of that September hire and that update
gave
us on staff.
Yes.
Anything else? Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion that we continue with this in-house.
Second. Call the roll.
Becker?
No.
Ray?
Yes.
Spurs?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
No.
Hicks?
Yes.
Hickla?
Yes.
Okay. All righty. Number six, consent agenda. Are there any items on the consent agenda that you'd like removed and discussed separately? And if not, I need a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second. Call the roll.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Hickla?
Yes.
Becker?
Yes.
Okay, number seven, ordinances. Third reading, 2249, City Ordinance, Parking Stalls, Chapter 69, Section 69.14.
So moved.
Second.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Pitt?
Yes.
Kikwas?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes. Move to adopt.
Second.
Call the roll.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Pitt?
Yes.
Kikwas?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
Okay, number eight, I have no comments this evening. Number nine, any council comments?
I have one, John.
Yes.
Ribbon cutting tomorrow at US Cellular. So, thank you.
I had a question about the North Old Come and Go. Do we have an ETA on when that sign is gonna get up there?
How about that light pole?
Yeah.
How about that thing?
Anybody? On the south side, the one downtown?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing, every time I drive under it, I think it's gonna go any time.
We've inquired about it, but it's.
Somebody worked on it.
They say it's gonna be taken care of this spring.
Yeah, somebody worked on it. It's not going to work.
Ed, did you look at that?
Yeah, we did.
Did it say?
We have communication about it right after it happened. They came back, I think they went through, I don't know if they went to Uville or JR or somebody, but they claimed that it's stable. I went out and looked at it, you know, I'm not, I can't push a light pole over, but I don't really trust it.
I don't either.
Yeah.
I think it's just getting a little bit, I don't know.
Yeah, well, I had calls on it and, you know.
Well, they think it looks terrible.
I was worried that if they got ice, you know, we got an inch of ice, you know.
The ground's frozen. It's not going to work.
I know.
For now.
For now, that's right.
Yeah, okay.
Just council, want staff to reach out or do any, what would you like?
So that's a light.
But the signage is a light.
Have they applied for a permit or anything yet?
No, they could have asked, you know, building plans on buildings, on both buildings. Maybe copies of them.
I mean, both stores, they're.
Took them 6 weeks to be able to take a debit card.
Do you have a contact with them? You could send them a letter.
Six all though.
Okay.
The south one isn't so bad because at least it looks like a regular store.
Right.
The north one is pretty bad looking.
It does.
I mean, thank you, be bad for business.
Yeah.
We actually did ask, well, staff did look into the thing, the light thing, that's kind of, I don't know how much you really could push them to get their sign put up. I mean, it's kind of a corporate thing, I think.
I don't know.
Is there a timeline on when you should have signage?
I'll imagine.
I think we'll get one to ask.
Yeah.
You know, what's going on?
I imagine every time I go in there, but don't do anything.
They don't.
People worry more about that than they do other stuff.
I just wanna get my pop, that's all I care. Need to pop open.
Any other council comments? Any public comments, right, is not on the agenda.